Hey guys, my name is Helen Chemes. I am a rising junior biomedical engineering student at the University of Rochester. So today we will be talking about bioreporters and biosensors. So first of all, for this module, prepare by reading the paper about biosensors and their applications. This paper briefly discusses the different types of biosensors and how they're applied in different fields. It focuses on an interesting array about how they're applied in food, drug production, and ecology. Also, please take a second to open the Google form for Module 5 so you can fill the necessary questions when needed. All right. So, a module overview. First of all, what we'll be talking about in this module. We're going to be talking about what are biosensors, how are biosensors used in synthetic biology, and why are they important in our lives. Then, what are bioreporters? What are the applications of biosensors and bioreporters? And what are the types of biosensors? So, let's start talking a bit about biosensors. So, biosensors are analytical devices that could be enzyme-based, tissue-based, or use antibodies, and sometimes a full cell to convert biological responses into chosen electrical, thermal, or optical signals that then we can read. So, as you can see here, the first image is choosing the specific molecule that we would be recognizing or we'll be working with. Next step is choosing our transducing element. Then this transducing element would be able to convert the specific biochemical signal into an electrochemical signal, an optical signal, an electric signal, a thermal signal. And then we could use our current technology to digitally amplify those signals and then display them. This data and then taken that we can easily read it or amplify it however way we want. So as I mentioned earlier, there are two parts. First of all, the biorecognition element, like the antibody, the phage, the DNA, the enzyme, or the biomimetics. And then there's the transducing element, which is our sensor. So what are the types of those biosensors? So the first of all is the electrochemical biosensors. Electrochemical biosensors use electrochemical transducers to detect specific ligands, tissues, and sometimes non-biological matrices. And that's what makes them very practical and sensitive, and they have very fast results. Next is optical biosensors. Optical biosensors are devices that use optical measurements, such as absorbance or fluorescence. And one of the most common applications for the sensor is the blood glucose estimation, which we will be discussing later in this video. So next, there are thermal sensors. Thermal sensors use thermal resistance to measure a change in the heat resulting from enzymatic reactions. So for example, for serum cholesterol, so basically when cholesterol is oxidized by cholesterol oxidase enzyme, heat is generated, and that could be measured using those thermal biosensors. Also, another thing where thermal biosensors are important, such as in fermentation or biocatalysts or food technology. So now here we can see how biosensors have evolved since 1956 till more or less today. So it all started with Leland C. Clark, who is an American biochemist born in Rochester. He's also known as the father of all biosensors. So he was called the father of all biosensors because he created the biosensor that could determine the glucose blood levels. So glucose biosensor is an optic biosensor. It's made up of immobilized enzymes such as glucose oxidase, horseradish peroxidase, and toluidine. The optic biosensor measures the intensity of a dye, which can be measured by using a portable reflectance meter. Thus, leading this device to be kind of the essence of the devices used for diabetes patients today. So we talked about the first steps, but how are biosensors used today? So in this diagram, we can see like there's a collection of different biosensors. Most of these devices use like different body fluids, such as tears here, saliva, sweat, blood, to detect diseases in the most efficient way possible and in a way that is closest to the specific biosensor. So this leads us to our first activity. So please open the Google form. The first thing is, what are biosensors? And then I want you, first of all, to answer which biosensor from this list would you like to have? Why? And then if you can create your own biosensor, what would you choose? Be as creative as possible. Of course, you can use this diagram for inspiration. But is there a disease you'd like to solve? Or would you like to find a detection method for? Which fluid would be using for that specific disease? I'll give you 5 seconds to pause this video and start answering these questions. All right, now that you've answered those questions, let's talk about why do we use biosensors. So first of all, biosensors are very sensitive. They are eco-friendly. They're easy to make, and they are very simple monitoring devices. They could be mass-produced. They could be very specific to whichever substance we are trying to measure. They are relatively cheap. They have fast responses and accurate measurements. So why are they sometimes hard to use is because poor reproducibility. The system is temperature dependent, especially, for example, on the thermal biosensors. And also biosensors are sensitive to pH changes. So this could also be affected severely in the experiment. Okay, now that we were done with biosensors, please again open the Google form and answer questions 2 to 4. So I will give you also another 5 seconds to do that. Now that you're done, let's talk about bioreporters. So bioreporters are microorganisms, cell cultures, or cell lines that tend to be genetically engineered with a certain activity that can reflect changes in the environmental changes depending on certain responses. So they are useful because of their ability to measure bioavailable concentrations. They are cost-effective and can have multiple targets, and it can detect groups of compounds instead of a certain specific single target. Bioreporters can be really interesting. Some of them are extracted from jellyfish, which is like GFB and RFB, which are for fluorescence. As you can see, what happens is we put the tracer and it binds to the protein, which joins the promoter, thus giving us the specific protein binded with the reporter that we want, or for example, the fluorescent that we want. And this then we can read and making the bioreporters very useful to us to be able to read specific protein production in the cells. So application of bioreporters. The best uses of bioreporters are two different tests. One is the Humochromo test kit, which has high speed detection for genotoxicity or DNA damage. And the other device is the Microtox, which is a natural bio luminescence, and it uses the bacteria, the bioluminescent bacteria, to detect toxic substances in water, air, soil, and etc. So what's next for bioreporters? So first of all, synthetic biology provides could provide more ways of constructing and engineering the bioreporters. It's also possible to work on having more strains compared to fewer strains that we're currently working on. We could look into how to preserve a bioreporter in the cells without ruining its activity, and how to eliminate the regulatory issues with a bioreporter assay, and finally, how to be able to predict the performance of the cell when compared to usual standards. So now that we are done with this section, you can answer the Google form once again, questions 5 to 7. So I'll give you another 5 seconds to be able to pause and head to that section. All right. Thank you all for attending this module. Please make sure you've answered all of the questions on the Google form. Have a good day and good luck with the rest of the modules.